Good afternoon and welcome to Stefan's PhD defense. My name is Birte Holst-Jørgensen and I have the pleasure to chair the next maximum 3 hours. So, welcome to our examiners, Professor Torjus Bolkesjø from the Norwegian University of Life Sciences, Associate Professor Thomas Balstrøm from the University of Copenhagen, and the Chair of the Assessment Committee, Senior Researcher Geraldine Henningsen from our own department. Also, welcome to the main supervisor, the co-supervisor couldn't make it today, Kenneth Carlson. Of course, welcome to you, Stefan.
Thank you.
The main person today, and welcome to you, the whole audience. As I said, the defense will maximum take 3 hours. We will start out by a presentation by Stefan, around 45 minutes. Then we'll have a break, and afterwards the assessment committee will make their questions, challenging questions to Stefan. If any of you from the audience also wants to make some questions, please notify me during the break. Then you are allowed also to make some interesting questions to Stefan. But let's start out with your 45 minutes presentation, Stefan.
Thank you, Birte. Thank you all for coming. Today I'll present my PhD thesis, Geographic Information Systems and Energy System Modeling for Analysis of Renewable Energy Systems. And in my PhD work, my supervisor was Kenneth Carlson, my co-supervisor was Ben Müller from University of Flensburg, previously University of Aalborg. So this is my plan for the presentation. So I'll start with research questions. I'll introduce the relationship between energy system models and GIS. I'll present models and tools developed during my PhD work. Then I'll speak briefly about the papers, then about the elements which go through all the papers. Then I'll go through heat demand and heat savings, district heating and residential heat pumps. Then I'll present how is that presented in the papers. Then I'll say how this answers the research questions, and then I'll have one slide about future work I plan to perform. So energy system models and GIS, and so is it necessary and why do we do that? And in this small illustration, GIS is located on the left side, while a simple, very simple representation of the energy system is located on the right side. As you can see, we have a supply sector, we have power and heat sector, supply sector, power and heat sector. And then these sectors are delivering fuels, power and heat to residential, industrial, transport sector, and so on. And first thing is, do we really need GIS for this? No, we can build an energy system model directly from the statistics, but then we'll miss an important things which are geographical in nature. So for example, resources, wind, solar, waste, they are distributed in space, and so then the supply sector is different in different areas, in different geographical areas in the model. And for example, I took some examples from Danish Times model, heating areas, heating demand, heat savings, they are different from one area to another. So when we feed the geographical definition, when we feed them to energy system models, we get better results. As an example of results, power prices, they are different from East and West Denmark, if we're talking Denmark, and heat, it's very different whether you can supply heat from district heating, whether from central district heating or from decentral district heating or from individual heating, and then it also influences the price of heat savings. And then the idea is when the results from energy system models are produced, then they can be returned back to GIS and presented. For example, where to do heat savings, or where to put windmills, is it onshore, offshore, and so on. So the point is, yes, we can make energy system models without GIS, but it's better this way. And the research questions which I addressed in this thesis is, which elements should be added to GIS Energy Atlas and how it could be used with energy system models to improve strategic energy planning, what kind of pre-processing and aggregation procedures can be applied on GIS data in order to effectively utilize them in energy system models. how could data from national energy system models be disaggregated so they can be used in detailed GIS databases, and which scenario describes the optimal pathway for developing of future heat supply in the Danish energy system. During my PhD, I was a part of the development of four models and tools. It's times decay, where I contributed to development of power and heat and residential sector. I developed a DTU energy atlas, as well as Jinkopi's scan energy atlas and the heating model. And these three elements will be later elaborated within this presentation. I also included in the TCA 8 papers. Out of them, it's 7 journal papers and 1 conference paper. And 5 of them got published by now, 2 are under review. And in the presentation, I will touch upon papers 2, 3, and 7. These papers they have different focus. On one side, they have different the focus on different time periods, and they have focus on different geographical locations. So in geography, they go from local, very local, in paper about Munksugor, and then on regional level for Rinkonbisken municipality, and then all the others are on national level. They also touch upon different time periods, especially in assessment of future energy system in times, they go until 2050. In some papers, it's resource assessment, and in some, it's very short time periods. I also touch upon different technologies in the papers. So heat savings, district heating, residential heat pumps, wind turbines, district heating, and in the analysis with times, then I touch upon whole energy system. And, there are 3 elements which go through all the papers or almost all the papers, and they are listed in the table. So one is energy systems analysis. The other one is geographical aspects of energy systems, and third one is heat demand, heat supply, and heat savings in buildings. And I use 3 symbols here. One is when it's bolded plus, then it means that this is a main thing in the paper. Then the not bolded plus is means that it is mentioned in the paper, it's used in the paper, but not that is a main thing. And then minus means it's not utilized in the paper. So as you can see, geographical aspects of energy systems are used in all the papers. I'll start to speak about heat demand in buildings. So it's a funny illustration, but I'll try to explain what does it mean. So basically, the goal is to maintain sufficient indoor temperature, 21 degrees of indoor temperature, but most biggest part of the year outdoor temperature is lower than the indoor temperature, so we have transmission losses, so the heat is going out of the house, and because of transmission losses through windows, through walls, through roof, and then we have some ventilation losses because this small guy here, he also needs fresh air so he can live. This small guy here and his electrical appliances, they also produce some heat, which heats the building. And the most important thing, we need to supply heat from outside. And this can be individual boiler, such as oil boiler or natural gas boiler, or it could be district heating. Third option is, of course, to save heat, which I'll come later. And if I express it as a equation, then this is the heat which needs to be supplied from external source. This is the surplus heat from people and electrical appliances. We have transmission, and this needs to be equal to transmission losses plus ventilation losses plus demand for domestic hot water. What I would like you to pay attention to is that these transmission losses, they are proportional to U values of elements and the difference between internal indoor and outdoor temperature. The same goal for ventilation losses. This is the efficiency of heat recovery. It's proportional to difference between indoor and outdoor temperature. Domestic hot water is calculated as a ratio between, and this is over all age groups. A determines A denotes age group, so it's energy needed to heat the water, expressed as expressed as kilowatt-hours per person, and this is area of heated area per person expressed as person per square meter. This is assumption which I input to the model, and this one is measured by Danish statistics. I can illustrate it with two small graphs. So this is energy needed to heat the water from 55 degrees, and I assume that different age groups consume different amounts of hot water. So this is my input. This is what Danish statistics measures, the square meters per person in every age group. When I divide these two, I get domestic hot water consumption. And this is, I'm mentioning this because I had different approaches in the past. So one was to go to measured values. There is one report about domestic hot water where they measure values. The other thing is what Danish Energy Agency assumes, just assume 25 kilowatt-hours per square meter and so on. So I think that this one is actually an improvement. Now I want to say, how do I see buildings in GIS? So first of all, and this is just one snapshot from Rinkopingskjern municipality towns, Len and Hoymark. And the point here, one building in GIS is one point in the BBR register. So what I know about the buildings, and I want you to remember, I'll say it a few times during the presentation, we know geographic location, we know construction year, we know use. So is it single family, multifamily? Is it regihus? Then we know what kind of heat supply it gets. Is it natural gas? Is it oil? Is it district heating? We know what is the heated area. And we have the information about heat delivery, meaning we know whether this building has natural gas delivery district heating. And I use it to check. This information is used to check this information. But I'll come to that later. Then we come to a heating model. How does it work? So heated areas per building group and per type of heating are aggregated, meaning building group is a group defined by common construction period and common use, and then as well as common type of heating. So common construction period is I include here 9 construction periods. The reason for including 9 is because SBI, the Danish Building Research Institute, gathers the data on that level. So I just take the same level. And the same goes for use of buildings. I use the BBR codes for that. So then I have from BBR register, I get, from SBI's reports, I get physical characteristics of buildings. From Danish statistics, I get population data, how much person live per square meter. And then I get some user inputs, I'll come back to that. I use that to calculate specific heat demand for space heating and domestic hot water. I group buildings in the way they're grouped in Danish statistics, Danish energy statistics. And I perform an iterative procedure and move these user inputs in order to achieve sufficient calibration. And this is the list of user inputs. There are a lot of them. So efficiency of domestic hot water, consumption of domestic hot water per age group, recovery of losses within the building, from domestic hot water distribution, indoor temperature, thermal capacity of buildings, and so on. So there are many levels of freedom here, and I only change these three, and the other ones I keep fixed, so it gets easier to calibrate the model. These are the results of calibration. So if we look on single-family and multifamily level, one is calculated, and it's matching Danish energy statistics, and as you can see, SBI's numbers, they're a bit higher than that. If we go to fuel, then in some smaller building groups, the mismatch can be bigger, but the idea is that this is matched on type of buildings and fuel. And as you can see, Danish energy statistics calculated, so it's a... Now let's go back to our building, and so as I said here, there are basically two options for supply. One is district heating and the other one is individual heating. But what would be the third option? So reduction of heat demand. And how our little friend, what can he do? Sorry. He can invest in new roof. He can make better walls. and then the transmission losses are reduced. As we can see here, then as I told before, you should now I ask you to focus on this. So U value changes. So we now have U value all before the renovation minus U value after the renovation, and the remaining remains more or less the same. And these are the heat savings. So the difference between heating demand, or in this case heating losses, before and after the renovation. As you can see, then the error becomes smaller. So the ventilation losses can also get smaller by introducing mechanical ventilation systems with heat recovery. And also, this is the efficiency, the new efficiency of heat recovery, and this is old. And in case that the building didn't have mechanical ventilation systems with heat recovery, then this one was zero. And now these losses also get smaller. But for domestic hot water, you remember the third element, well, I don't consider that this can be reduced. Of course, there are ways to reduce it, to shut down hot water during night, or to reduce the length of circulation pipes and so on, but this is not included in the analysis. So in this analysis, domestic hot water is only the consequence of human behavior and cannot be reduced by heat savings. Now I want to show how it's done in the heating model. So I assume certain renovation levels, and for example, renovation levels are for walls are 100 millimeters of insulation, 200, 300 millimeters. For windows, it's installing C windows, B windows, A plus windows, and each of these result in certain heat savings, and result in certain costs, and per unit costs are also obtained from SBI reports. So basically, when I include lifetimes and interest rate, I can calculate the price of kilowatt hour saved. Then, with some inclusion of renovation rates and with inclusion of construction and demolition rates, to the potentials and annualized costs, or to the heat saving curves, we get inputs to we get approximation and we get heat saving curves first. I apologize for this. So after this bracket, we get potentials and annualized costs of heat savings, actually heat saving curves. And when we add construction and demolition rates and renovation rates and approximate these curves, we can feed these data into energy system models. Example of these curves. So for example, curves for floors, curves for walls. What does it show? So these are all different building types. So different uses, different construction periods, and always the cheapest element is chosen. So the one which results in the lowest price in Danish crowns per kilowatt hour out of all the renovation measures. These curves are then aggregated into one big curve, but this curve has, I think, 700 or 360 steps, the blue curve. So it's not continuous, but it has 360 steps. And it's not possible to feed such a curve in energy system model. So to avoid this problem, before feeding the data into times, it's approximated with three steps of potentials, of potentials, costs, and lifetimes that's calculated in the back, because each of these is composed of different elements, walls, floors, windows, and so on. Again, I'm coming back to this slide. How does the building look in GIS? It's a point in all this data. What is fed into times decay? The approximated curves of potentials and costs are grouped by region, East and West Denmark, building type. In times, we consider two building types, two residential building types, single family and multifamily buildings, construction period before and after 1972. And position relative to existing district heating areas, central, decentral, and individual. Actually, individual, of course, I'll show later, it's not a district heating area, of course, it's a group of individual buildings. And these potentials and costs are approximated with three steps. I want to say a few words because I'm mentioning times, but I haven't said what is times and what is times decay. So times is an acronym from the integrated Markov-Ifom system. It was developed and is maintained by ETSAP, Energy Technology Systems Analysis Program. It is a technology-rich bottom-up model generator utilized for long-term analysis and planning of energy systems. It's also techno-economic partial equilibrium model generator, assuming full foresight and perfectly competitive markets. Its times models are linear programming problems, and their goal is to minimize the objective function. And the objective function in times models are the total system costs discounted to the base year for discounting. Just a small explanation. So times models basically are choosing investment and operation of energy system from the base year to the end of analyzed period. Times decay model or times model for Denmark. It was developed in Energy Systems Analysis Group together with Danish Energy Agency and Italian consultancy company E4SMA. This is the only full foresight optimization model which covers all sectors of the Danish energy system. Sectors representing the model are residential, power and heat, transportation, private service, public service, construction activity, manufacturing, agriculture, and other. So TIMES is national, multi-regional energy system model. It is represented by two regions, East and West Denmark, as we can see on the map. West Denmark on the left, East Denmark on the right. Time is represented in form of time slices, and time slices are hours with similar characteristics within the same year. And I'll show you here what does it mean. So we basically aggregate in times the hours with similar characteristics. So, and these 32 time slices are obtained by combining seasons, so spring, summer, fall, winter, workday and non-workday, and four critical situations in the Danish power system. And the critical situations are high power demand and low wind, low power demand and high wind, high PV, and other remaining time slices. So the idea is not to have many time slices, but to capture the critical situations. Times decay uses domestic and imported resources, and the base year of the model is 2010. Okay, domestic and imported, renewable and non-renewable. I'll present it on the next slide. So this slide is maybe the most illustrative for times. Times covers all the energy transformation from primary energy on the left side, all to energy services on the right side. And it goes to power and heat sector, to biorefineries, to fuel sector, and then electricity is produced, fuels are produced, and they are later utilized in residential, transport, industry, and other sectors. So it covers everything from primary energy or extraction, and then to final energy. And each of these boxes, each of these sectors gets one commodity in, and then one or more commodities in, and one or more commodities out. So it's all one big set of transformations of energy. How is district heating represented in times decay? So there are two regions, East and West Denmark, and two types of networks, central and decentral district heating networks. Central district heating networks are bigger networks, have more consumers, higher installed capacities, higher efficiencies, and on the opposite, decentral networks are smaller networks, have less consumers, smaller installed capacities, and lower efficiencies. And we can see them on the map in the green color. Our central district heating networks, so as you can see, they're located in the big cities, so Copenhagen, Odense, Aarhus, Aalborg, and so on. While decentral district heating networks are located in smaller, you see the blue areas, so they're located in smaller cities. And we have two types of areas. We have district heating areas and next two district heating areas. District heating areas are the ones where the majority of buildings already have district heating. Of course, there are some buildings within district heating areas which do not have district heating, but majority does. And then we have next two district heating areas, they are expansion potentials for expansion. This is a part of Zealand on the map. So in dark green, we have district heating areas. And then in the light green, next two district heating areas, central. And the same goes for these central district heating areas. In dark blue, it's district heating areas, and then in the light blue, it's expansion potentials. And we have in the, maybe not so visible, in the pink color, it's individual areas where expansion of district heating is not modeled. Yep. So we have two types of expansion potentials within existing district heating areas and in the next two district heating areas. All of these potentials and costs in similar way as for heat savings, they're approximated with, just in this case, with two-step curves. We can see them on the next slide. So this is the curve describing the connection cost for decentral district heating areas located in West Denmark. And then this curve is also composed on many, many small steps. So instead of fitting this very complicated curve, these two potentials and costs are fed into times decay, and then times can decide whether to connect these buildings or not. Is it optimal for the society to connect these buildings to district heating or not? And lifetimes and investment costs are different for distribution pipes, air connecting pipes, and heat exchangers. And the topic of connecting district heating areas, connecting buildings which still do not have district heating, is analyzed in paper 2. So I'll just present one result from paper 2. So how to use heat atlas or energy atlas for calculation of costs of expanding existing district heating networks. It's a district heating area next to Roskilde, or actually Roskilde is here, and our former workplace Risu is somewhere here, and then the how to calculate the cost of expanding these district, how to connect this district heat, this small individual area to this big district heating area. And well, I distinguish between transmission, distribution, and connecting infrastructure. And in this case, to connect, it is assumed that this individual area does not have transmission, distribution, or connecting infrastructure inside. So to connect it, we need to pay for all three types of infrastructures. So transmission infrastructure plus distribution infrastructure plus connecting infrastructure. And this means connecting pipes and heat exchangers. And then since it is known which buildings are located here, then according to their heating demand, they are divided into small, medium, and large. And then the price of connecting pipes and heat exchangers are different for different buildings. And here is also utilized the information known about buildings. So the information that it is exactly known which buildings are here and that their heat demand is not known, but it's estimated. Based on that, the connecting price is calculated. And it is the same for next two district heating areas, just that they do not need to pay for connecting infrastructure. And then I'll come to the next paper, heat supply planning for ecological housing community Muksugor. So it, and as we can see on the map, Muksugor is a small housing community located next to Roskilde. It's composed out of five building groups around a small farmhouse built in year 2000. And there we compared three types of analysis, and then we also compared the results with voting, with the results of voting. So first one is techno-economic energy systems analysis done with times, then simple private economic analysis and private economic analysis with externalities done in a spreadsheet model. Later we compared it with results of voting. However, it is very important what kind of results we get for district heating. Since Muksugor is a building, is a group of buildings which are all located within central district heating areas in Denmark East, and they're all single-family houses. Here I'm presenting the results for single-family buildings located in central areas in Denmark East. And in all three scenarios, I can briefly say this is base scenario, no constraints. This is VOP scenario, where the only constraint is 50% of electricity production needs to come from wind starting from 2020, and VLP NFE scenario on top of VLP scenario says that non-fossil fuels can be used in production of electricity and heat from 2035. So in all the scenarios, majority of buildings in these areas should be connected to district heating. So giving one message that buildings within district heating areas should be connected to district heating from socioeconomic point of view. Yes. And it is also presented how these district heating, central district heating, will be produced in the future. So in the base scenario with no constraints, central district heating will still be produced in large scale coal-based CHPs. While when 50% of wind comes in from 2020, then the part of the production switches to large-scale heat pumps, and then waste comes in. While in the renewable scenario, most of central district heating is produced from large-scale heat pumps, and then the smaller part comes from waste boilers, and small part comes from waste heat from industries. However, in the other types of analysis, we concluded that from private economic perspective, it would be a close competition between biomass and connecting to district heating. While people living there, they voted in favor of biomass boilers and large scale heat pumps, and then the decentralized heat pumps. I'm going back to the same slide. I will link it to the next paper. So one building, one point on the map. And these are the information we have about it. I'm moving to paper 3, residential heat pumps in the future Danish energy system. It's also where I used GIS and times decay to see what is the role of residential heat pumps in the future Danish energy system. Three types of residential heat pumps are modeled in this paper: air-to-air, air-to-water, and brine-to-water for two types of buildings. COPs, unlike in previous studies, are modeled as temperature-dependent COPs. The point was that the heat pumps perform the poorest in winter, when actually the heat is most wanted. It seemed reasonable to look into this aspect, that COP is not fixed. COP really depends on the temperature of the source. And then I introduced area constraints. So do we really have enough space to extract enough heat to supply building with heat? So space can be a constraint. And then other techno-economic parameters, which are presented in this table. Maybe there is not enough heat. Maybe there is not enough space to install ground source heat pumps. And the point was that if we get a lot of ground source heat pumps in Copenhagen, maybe it's not feasible. So that was the reason for looking into this. Have a small sketch together with the formula. So this is how in one formula how the investigation went. I'll come here so I can see it. So if you have a building boundary, and we have this small dot here, and based on its construction period and use, I calculated the amount of heat it demands. Then I say, okay, if this is the parcel where it's located, this is the green stuff, it's area of parcel where we can actually install pipes for ground source heat pumps. So is there enough space to extract enough heat? And the amount of heat which can be extracted from ground and supplied to this building is calculated as specific heat from the ground multiplied by total area, multiplied by a factor which says K area, which says which is the part of this building parcel which can be utilized to put pipes in the ground. So for some obstacles or something, it's not possible to utilize all the green area. Full load hours and the average COP. And based on this, I've calculated how much heat is possible to supply to this building from the green area. And the same for all parcels in Denmark. And there is another there is another rule. Heat pump can only supply its own building's demand and not the neighbor's. So for example, if a heat pump can cover 100 megawatt hours and the building's demand is 50, then heat pump can produce at max 50. So it's not possible that if I have a big parcel and a small building, I can extract a lot of heat and then that I can supply my neighbor who has a, on the opposite, has a small parcel and a very big building. So that's not possible. And example two, if heat pump can cover 100 megawatt hours and demand is 150, so it can at most supply 100, and then you need another, source of heat. These results for all parcels in Denmark are aggregated based on the region and based on the building type. And these numbers are later fed into times, and then the model knows, okay, I can only supply 4.8 terawatt hours of heat from residential heat pumps in Denmark East single family house. Just results from electricity production from the same paper. Even though I analyzed three scenarios, they are very similar to each other because only some conditions related to heat pumps are changing. So I'm only presenting one scenario. And as we can see briefly, that electricity production is in the renewable scenario is very much based on wind, offshore and onshore wind. The VLP scenario from the previous paper is actually the base scenario in this paper, meaning that 50% of electricity production needs to come from wind in 2020, and fossil fuels cannot be used for production of electricity and heat starting from 2035. And also, in all the scenarios, Denmark is constrained to be next net exporter of electricity. When we come to a bit more interesting slides regarding residential heat supply, on the left side is presented heat delivered to residential consumers is presented. So we have central district heating, decentral district heating, and individual heating. Individual heating is oil, natural gas, biomass, ground source heat pumps, and we have heat savings going in the opposite direction. From this, I can say that central district heating appears to be very strong, so it cannot be hurt even if heat pumps are totally released. And yeah, well, I said what is the base scenario. In no investment in heat pump scenario, it's simply said you cannot invest in heat pumps. It's not realistic. It's just to show how would it look. And then no constraint on investment in heat pumps is simply I would not respect my constraints on the ground area, just to see, is it beneficial for the system to install more heat pumps than there is ground for? And in no investment of heat pumps, we can see, okay, the system works. It's possible to work without ground, without heat pumps at all. Simply the residential consumers will be supplied by biomass boilers and solar heating and a bit more district heating. You see, individual heating is smaller, so it will be supplied by more district heating. And in the case that the model can install as much as heat pumps as it wants, then more ground source heat pumps come in than in the base scenario. If you focus on heat savings to show that actually it matters where the buildings are, then I took no investment heat pump scenario and plotted these heat savings here on the right side. And what we can see is that heat savings are mostly implemented in individual areas, so where district heating cannot reach these buildings. So they have choice, okay, we can be supplied by individual heating or we can do heat savings. And most of heat savings come in individual areas. And in central district heating areas, it's a very small number and comes close to 2050. Times also gives total system costs and give environmental emissions. So, as expected, in the no investment heat pump scenario, since it's the most constrained scenario, the total system costs are the highest, and that's mainly because of import of because of fuel costs and actually because of import of biomass. In the sensitivity analysis, I've explored. On the left side, you can see the sensitivity actions. On the right side are the parameters which are monitored. And I just took some of the most important ones. So the system costs are mostly affected if you forbid heat savings. Okay, that's not realistic, but this hurts the system the most in terms of costs. And if the price of wind turbines is changed, since the system is very much based on wind electricity, then this hurts the total system cost as well. CO2 emissions are naturally very much hurt by the price of biomass. So if the price is higher, the model will not use biomass, and the opposite, we do not include emissions on biomass. And I'll say one thing, that for ground source heat pumps, it is very beneficial if reduction factor is changed to 0.8 from 0.5. And that is the part of parcel area which can be utilized to put pipes. So it increases by 23%. So 23% is in relative numbers is a lot. It's not that much, but still it would be more beneficial for the system to be able to install more and to produce more from ground source heat pumps. We come to answers to research questions. So which elements should be added to GIS Energy Atlas, and how it could be used with energy system models to improve strategic energy planning? So this is the investigated in all papers, and was very much focused on the papers about Rinkobinskian municipality, where I tried to gather all the data which I could find useful. I can say that energy resources are very important. They differ whether it's, for example, East or West Denmark. Is it offshore, onshore? Is it densely populated areas? They are rich in waste, or because we see waste as a resource. Is it north, south, where the solar is different? Then energy supply and demand. So it's very important to know where the existing district heating plants are and where the demand is located. Basically, where are the buildings? It's important to know where is transmission and distribution infrastructure. If there is no infrastructure, then it either needs to be built, which has some cost associated, or if there is, then it's cheaper to supply electricity and heat. What kind of pre-processing and aggregation procedures can be applied on GIS data in order to effectively utilize them in energy system models? And about the approximation, the results obtained from GIS analysis are approximated with step curves, and later they are fed into times decay energy system model. And regarding aggregation, maximum demands which can be supplied by heat pump are aggregated based on type of buildings, and they're aggregated based on the geographical region. And then as such, they're fed into times decay. And also the buildings are aggregated according to use, according to construction period, and that's basically in all the analysis. And then in the analysis of expansion of district heating, they aggregate according to annual heating demand, location to existing district heating areas. Then in the paper about waste, road networks are aggregated, no matter if they are different sizes, they are aggregated into one road network, so on. How could data from national energy system models be disaggregated so this data can be used in detailed spatial GIS databases? So on one hand, times decay and Balmorel, there are two energy system models. They have the same regions defined in the model, actually have the geographical background. So if the model decides to invest in central district heating areas east, we have these on the map as I showed, so we can simply associate production or investments with the areas. The same goes for Balmoral areas. And in papers 1 and 5, and mostly in 5, I showed how heat savings can actually, if I know building type and if I know the amount of heat savings which can be performed, then, and I know the location of building, I can present it in GIS. And in paper about Rinkobinskian, I did very detailed job on that, saying, okay, I go into 1 square kilometer, and then I know this is the building use, this is the building size, this is the building age, and so on. And that's how I presented the results. And which scenario describes the optimal pathway for developing of heat supply in the future Danish energy system? So of course, if we speak about future renewable energy systems, so we cannot really look separately electricity and heat and separately from coal energy system. So the electricity will mostly be based on wind power. We see that district heating should be expanded, buildings heating demand should be reduced by heat savings and also partly by construction, by demolition and construction of new and more efficient buildings. Residential heat pumps should be present in areas where district heating is not feasible, and many more. It's very difficult to say in one sentence what should we do with the future Danish energy system, but this stuff, we can take it further. Future work. I intend to do some future work also. There is lots of work left. So I plan to continue working with energy system models in GIS. I would like to utilize population and construction demolition projections to use heating model as a standalone tool for projecting future heating demands, to visualize results from heating model in GIS in the way how I did it for Rinkovi's scan paper, but to do it, to have it live linked, to do it automatically. Then for regarding times decay, the plan is to model non-residential buildings as buildings. Now they're modeled as industries, to introduce waste heat from industries in DTU Energy Atlas. I'm doing some work on that already. Then to refine geographical representation of waste heat from industries and biorefineries in times decay. We already have them, but say refine the representation. Expand analysis of potentials for solar heating and PVs on rooftops. I already done some work on that, but I should refine and expand the analysis, and then analyze local energy resources like waste, biomass, sources for heat pumps, etc. Probably many more things to do in the future. And this is my last slide. Now I want to thank you for your attention, and yes, thank you for being here, and thank you for listening to me.